Welcome everybody here to what is our, well, take number three for this show, man. So there's going to be a couple of things which we won't go over. I will, however, let you guys know a couple of things. One, we're doing a Dota 2 show match. Myself, Toby Wong Kenobi, is my name. And we're doing Na'Vi versus Team Random. Now, Na'Vi, they're actually here inside the game. We're actually going to jump ourselves straight into this game because already in typical Na'Vi style, they are looking for blood before the game has even started. Well, the game actually technically starts with 1 minute and a half on the clock, and then you've actually got a minute and a half or so before the creep wave will actually spawn. But they're going to look for a kill on the bottom lane. Tunnel's going to be out of position for this, so Na'Vi will initiate to start with. Going to start with the Dendi hook to actually pull him back in again. He wants to get this hook right. There we go. Actually, a little bit too short on range. That level one hook range is pretty minimal, so Na'Vi don't end up getting the first blood on that bottom lane. The Lion was right, but it does mean they all have to have a long, long walk back. Rune's not in the bottom. Rune will be on the top. It will be a DD Rune. All right, so let's have a... we're going to have a third attempt at this. We're going to... actually, they're going to have another attempt at this as well. Clockwork Goblin wants to dive in behind the tower. And they put that ward there so they can see it there. The Hawk actually does land. Unable to actually chain with that stun from Who Ruined the World. And now we will see Clockwork Goblin actually go down. They'll try to do as much damage as they can, Na'Vi, but it's still not going to stop a force from dying. There's that time walk from Faceless Void, jumping himself over the top, which slows down Havorst, and that does secure his death. So not a fantastic start for Na'Vi, but these things kind of actually happen. So let's have a talk about our hero who actually just got that first blood. We'll check out our lanes in just a moment, and we'll see if we can miss as many, well, as few little first bloods as possible. Hello, initiate from middle lane. Looks like Tormented Soul. Also, there's Lashrak. Lashrak in the world of Dota, Dota 2. Also, there's Tormented Soul in the world of Dota 1. We'll look to initiate here on Ancient Apparition in the middle lane. So the man with the Russian spelling is about to be ganked off here. Arsart trying to come in as Juggernaut. And I'm good at playing as the Storm Spirit. And there goes our first stun here from Lashrak. Cold Feast on him. He has to run himself away. Good bounce down off there by the Wish Doctor to actually help out. And Arsart just diving that tower suicidally down. Dendi as well also wants to get the kill here on the Ancient Apparition, but will be unable to do so. Playing next to that Tier 1 tower. It's very suicidal early on in the piece. So Na'Vi, I think they're just trying some new roaming combinations to see just how far they can push themselves. And we will actually see that makes it actually 3-0 in favor of the Radiant. And Bounce Dunn will be able to halt the Storm Spirit in place just for a little bit longer. He's going to be a hard one to actually completely kill off as they have no more stuns, but they're still doing a fair amount of damage. But every single time you throw that damage, you've got to actually stop to actually do it. And, well, actually, he could have just lost his life by doing that. In fact, he actually did so. Arsart will want to see if he can get some revenge. Starts to spin up, gives himself magic community. And we'll need to pick up that Illusion Rune as well, and does do so. But the Gush will slow him down. There's no mana left in that Witch Doctor. He can't throw anything at this point. So Arsart will be safe up there on that high ground. So in the meantime, 4-0 into this game. Generally a team like Na'Vi, for those people like, hey, Na'Vi's fallen from grace. It's actually, they haven't really fallen from grace. Na'Vi are just one of those teams where they always love to try something new and different. They have, of course, recently had a bit of a roster change. They don't really feel as comfortable as they want to, and this is just a practice game. This isn't a proper show match in such sense. This is just them having some practice. There's no real stress. They can try new and different things. It doesn't count for, like, honor or anything. It's just me jumping into their public game here on the Dota 2 beta. So let's have a look at a couple of our heroes. That is something which we haven't done and we like to do here when we do our cast of joinDOTA. We like to actually edumacate all those people out there in the world. Oh, hello, Lich. He should be fine, though, unless Lashrak can actually land this stun, but very, very hard stun to actually land. So let's run through the Radiant. They're the first team I actually want to have a look at, especially this hero on the bottom lane. This is actually the fourth time, if you don't count the two... Well, third time, if you don't count the two times I've tried to do it in this match. Faceless Void... one of those fantastic carry heroes, and of course, as I say that, I'm watching mid actually getting themselves in position, but they should be fine. So Faceless Void, Time Walk is the first ability. It's what got him that first blood, jumping over the top and catching up to the man who's actually facing up against right now, Havorst, giving him that extra bit of, well, distance, leaping himself across. Because it does slow down Clockwork, his attack speed as well as his movement speed. As you can see, scales 25, 30, 35, and 40%. When I say scaling, I mean whenever you level up an ability, you scale the effect of that ability. So you can go up to level 4. Initiation on bottom lane. Witch Doctor might be looking for a bounce stun. Doesn't in the end, just does harassment. Next ability he's actually got, he's actually leveled up twice right now too. And it's a smart move as well. If you get the right chances, you can really stay on those front lines and not really fear anything. Backtrack. So you actually get to dodge it, and it's not like one of those, like, when you buy a stout shield, like, it's a 30% dodge chance. Hello, bounce done. It actually won't bounce back up again. I think they're hoping for a lucky bit of a bounce. In the end, they'll just become a little bit more of a buffer between Void and Clockwork. But yeah, so backtrack lets you actually dodge. So at the moment, up to level 2, up to 25%, which gives you obviously 1 in 4 if your percentage chance and calculations are good in your own head. So 1 in 4 chance to actually avoid an attack. Great later on in the game as well, especially if you actually pop off a whole bunch of backtracks in a row. You can really avoid those damage and win those fights, which you would never really think you could actually do so. Mid's actually engaging right now. Clockwork Goblin with a haste rune. Needs to get himself back out of that mid. As Ancient Apparition took a lot of damage, but it's the tower damage which actually kills off Clockwork. It was too close to the tower. Even with a haste rune, the tower attack still follows you up. As Juggernaut, I think, wants to jump in behind and actually find the Ancient Apparition, but he's already walking back to base, so there is no opportunity for him to actually do so. Gush is also on the Storm Spirit. Tunnan, if he gets close enough for another Gush, he can get that kill, but realizing Arsart is there, realizes this is actually probably not the best thing for him. So let's actually finish with Faceless Void. Time lock, so basically bash. So chance 10, 15, 20, 25. Extra bonus damage as well, and it's a 1 second bash time. But when you increase his bash speed, then you can basically demolish everything. Mask of Madness is actually one of the best items you can get on Faceless Void, and I'll explain why in just a moment. Obviously, it'll increase your lifesteal you actually get with every single attack, so you gain your life back again, but it also increases your attack speed, and that's really important when you pop your ultimate. It's called Chronosphere. So Chronosphere basically makes a big, well, dome of, it's a sphere, and this chrono. It holds time in place, basically. You can move around inside it, and now you see it actually leveled up. So they might try and use it to actually initiate in the bottom lane, so we might actually have ourselves a practical demonstration right now on Havorst, and yes, they will do so. So first bounce done needs to actually start this off as well as the Gush. He won't want to pop the ulti unless he actually has to, and well, there we go. It's the Chronosphere, which they've actually changed the animation on as well, bringing in the space below it all, and Power Cogs actually comes off from Clockwork Goblin, just pushing the Faceless Void back. He has no mana for that time walk, but Wish Doctor is able to get close enough to throw off one normal attack, which does the job. But obviously, Chronosphere, everything that goes in there, be it your ally, be it your enemy, everything actually stops. Nothing attacks. So that's why you want to use that extra time to attack freely, and you want to get that extra damage in that time, get yourself some life back when they can't interrupt your attacking speed. So that is a very, very, I would say, brief description, but it's not really that brief. Denny's in trouble. Denny's going to die right now, too. Lich with the Frost was going to be enough. Good stun actually coming up there from Lashrak, as well as Juggernaut trying to stay in front. And great time to actually spin the magic immunity, but it still wasn't enough. Lich with just the standard attack got the kill, but Lashrak with one also a standard attack got the revenge. So it's the Ancient Apparition ulti, which flew out towards the top lane. Well, hello mid. Bounce stun will hold me in place. Now she's chaining on that cold feet. Malediction as well as cast, and good hook there by Dendi, pulling the Tide into the range of the tower, so he took a lot of damage from the tower and rotted him too. So it was very, very hard to run away. That rot does actually have a little bit of a slow on it too, so 20% slow, and that's even from level 1. So a lot of Pudges do actually kind of like to level that one up a little bit slower than they would the hook. The hook does the more damage. As Rocker flies in towards the mid, so Denny was just wanting to know which one's the real one. Grabs the real one, and that's going to be it. Because you can tell the real one because the illusions take more damage than the real one. So Denny actually manages to find it out with the help from Clockwork Goblin. All right, so let's keep moving ourselves through the heroes while the engagements keep on going off. So Tidehunter on the bottom lane. He's one of the most favored support heroes at the moment. I'm actually going to watch Havorst a little bit more here on the bottom lane. I think he actually wants to initiate on the Faceless Void. He can't really do so, though, due to the main fact that, obviously, Juggernaut has no ultimate, and Clockwork Goblin, while he can hold him there, this is going to happen right now. The Gush will happen, mini stuns will pop, they need to actually get that support down there, so in we go, Arsart will just want to spin, Ancient Apparition ulti, thrown out as well. Not actually going to hit anything, it flew over the top of the Juggernaut while he was actually still in that magic immunity of the spin. Gush will slow down the Juggernaut as well as drop down that negative armor while we see Dendi actually kill off Lich in that, on the top lane. And Tidehunter with that big axe manages to get off the last hit. So we saw that Gush coming out from Tidehunter just then, so Gush also has another slow on top of it as well, so you can combine the Faceless Void slow as well as the Gush Also drops down the armor, so 2, 3, 4, 5. That's how much armor you lose with every single stack you've actually got. The Gush is basically the bread and butter of most Tidehunters. Storm Spirit jumping in towards the mid lane. We gotta pull in the Ancient Apparition, hold him in place long enough for Arsat to do enough damage with this spin. Maybe not. Nope, no, it will be enough. Lathrak actually ended up doing it with that Diabolic Edict, which we'll have a look at in just a moment too. Lathrak will good tower pusher. Really, really fantastic tower pusher. We'll tell you about that later. Kraken Shell is actually leveled up too, so damage reduction, you can see that going up as well. And also the damage threshold is, of course, reached. You can't have damage reduction for something which is just so big. So yes, damage reduction for the Kraken Shell, basically making Tidehunter into a bit of a tank. It's not really his main ability, though. He also has himself an Anchor Smash, which, again, reduces the damage of everybody around him, which does help him out a crap load. But his big ability, which everybody knows him for, is the Ravage. So when it pops off, stuns a very, very large area around him. And that is an AoE stun. And basically, where you're looking at this screen, from the middle of him, it will hit everything. Smoke and Deceit now popping off. They're going to look for a bit of a kill, and they're going to find Storm Spirit actually running down to the rune. And Storm Spirit, with a little bit of mana, decided, you know what, I may as well actually just jump this anyway. Lich's Mane should pick off actually a double kill on Juggernaut as well as Clockwork Goblin. In the meantime, Dendi is actually having fun with the Ancient Apparition. It's a good Gush as well as Cold Feet. Dendi was just lucky enough to stop himself from rotting before he actually got stunned. Right, of course, you can't be stunned when you want to stop the ability. Pops off an Urn Charge, gives himself a little bit more life, wants to escape out, but it's looking pretty dire right now, and that isn't actually a joke on it. And then the committing suicide. That was actually a little bit of a mistake there from the Radiant. Pudge is one of those heroes. He rots himself. I was talking about that rot. Gives a little bit of slow, a little bit of damage to the area around him as well. But what makes it even better is you actually take your own life away from yourself. Storm jumping top. Easy pull, easy kill. But yes, you basically sacrifice your own life points to create damage around you as well as a slow. It can work in two ways. Obviously, you can deal the damage, and it has a downside of you actually taking too much damage sometimes, so you find yourself in a really bit of a pickle with no life. But you can also deny yourself. There's no cap on it. Sometimes there's some abilities in Dota where you can't kill yourself. You can sacrifice your life, but it can never bring you to the point where you actually die. Pudge is a little bit different, so you got to make sure you actually kill him properly and don't give him that time to actually rot himself to death. Just trying to think who we actually haven't been through for the Radiant side. There's still a lot of them. Ancient Apparition, Global Presence Man. We're going to watch Witch Doctor first, and we might actually go with him. And Rocket actually reveals him off. They knew he had to be around there somewhere. And they do manage to find him. So that was the Clockwork Goblin only to bring him in very, very close fast there. So Witch Doctor, well, and straight off smoke, so Na'Vi really being aggressive. Nothing really surprising there at all. And Dendi, huge hook. Gets himself in a fantastic position. Ancient Apparition will try and throw the ultimate out there. Dendi is taking a little bit too much damage. He's going to get the revenge kill, the Ravage as well. It's more than enough damage, but actually the Ancient Apparition ulti didn't have the effect there on Dendi, so he'll actually have time to pop off his Urn Charge. Goes for a hook. He accidentally pulls off a Vorst. He wanted the Tidehunter, but Storm Spirit, I'm good, is able to do enough of the damage to finish him off. And now Lich is hunting this kill on Dendi again. And Wish Doctor actually trying to throw out a couple of stuns to help out his teammates here. And Storm Spirit taking a little bit too much damage there from the tower. We'll fall back, but still a double kill for the Storm Spirit. And Dendi just buys straight back into the game. Doesn't want to lose any time and wants to be aggressive down the bottom lane where the tier 1 tower is about to go down. It's a very, very fast-paced game of Dota, this one. And this is a comeback from Dendi. Yeah, smooth, man. It's a comeback from them being massively suicidal. Amazing hook. Dendi's Pudge is basically legend. Wait for it. Yeah, Dairy. The hooks which he can get, which he gets out is kind of nuts. He is one of the masters of the Pudge. Yes, yeah, so let's talk about Witch Doctor. So Witch Doctor, a lot of people know him as Moosh. A lot of people have known him from our live streams of Dota 2 as Carry Witch Doctor, the Carry support role, which doesn't really exist. It's just a joke that we currently run. No support should ever go Carry. He's a sacrifice for his team. Good hooking once again from Dendi. Ancient Apparition only might cause a couple of issues for him though, because he's actually cold feeted up. Will get locked in place. Needs to drop below 10% of his HP before he's actually going to die. Malediction actually popping off from Wish Doctor before he actually dies. Great Lich ultimate! Legends really playing some amazing ultimates and amazing battles here. Storm Spirit getting cold feeded up, and Lich gets himself a triple kill. Not really the hero they want that on, but it still works out. As long as they get the kills, they're going to be happy. Lich Alderman, so devastating. I want to jump onto him. We'll screw Witch Doctor. We'll go straight towards Lich. So, Lich, generally used for lane control, using the sacrifice. Sacrifices his own creep to actually take the mana, or converts the HP into mana. So, basically allows him to spam up those abilities. Generally, you see that as a level 1 ability. A lot of people will want to go that. Before leaving, I should go a damage-dealing spell like Frost Blast. That'll come up as your second level. Because you can keep on using this, and you sacrifice a creep, and when you take out one of these creeps, you take out 20% of the pushing power of this creep wave. So, by doing that, you keep him near the tier 1 tower early on in the game, and makes the lane control a lot better. That's why Lich just picked up when he's in a lane to support a hero, or just to keep it there himself. But we'll want to get that Frost Blast up as fast as he can. That's his good harassment, so he can sacrifice that mana and put it into something, and that's what drops down the life. And then, of course, the big ultimate, which you saw popping up before, and that is the Chain Frost. So when the Chain Frost goes, it basically bounces off. You can't select who it actually goes to, and Storm Spirit's now going to jump in and kill him off pretty easily. Even the Clockwork Goblin Rocket helping them off. And actually popping off the face, which is trying to actually escape back out there, but decided to turn and said, you know what, I'm dead anyway. Because Storm Spirit can chase me no matter where I go, so I'll just try and do a little bit of damage. Dendi having a bit of a look around. Going for a bit of a rando hook. He had the vision. Actually, no, that's the Radiant Vision. There. Dendi and Storm being massively aggressive. You've got to be really careful right now with Witch Doctor here. Storm's going to actually jump, but there's the Tunnel there. He does actually have that Ravage up too. He should pop it off right now. Does do so. They can kill up this Storm Spirit. They get him as well. Faceless Void is the one to actually do it before he time-walked himself back out again away from the Tormented Soul. Lashrak. There's no one to be near him when the Diabolic Edict goes off. So it ends up being a 1-1 trade. Storm for Tyre, but that's definitely a fair trade. The Force doesn't want to leave it at that, though. He's still looking for somebody else to kill, but we'll be unable to actually find anybody. They're grouping up pretty nicely, the Radiant. So yes, we're talking about Lich. So yeah, Chain Frost, big ultimate, bounces around, slows them down, and the jump range, obviously 575, the jump range couldn't be everything. So it always needs to be around heroes when it can actually bounce off. You want to be around heroes, not around creep waves. That's where you get the most effective ulti you possibly can. And there goes that Lich ultimate, but there's nothing for it to bounce to. So it just sits there. Frost as well. He thought there might be enough damage, but there's the magic wand charge, which brings the life back up again. Ancient Apparition really is making a bit of a buffer here for Lich to actually escape back out again, which he will manage to actually do so. While the rest of Na'Vi there on the front lines, just the buffer of heroes. Rocket flies out, and that rocket was actually going to probably hit a little bit further back. It hits around there. And I'll explain why that actually happened just then, too. Clockwork Goblin's going to get called out. Good AA ulti. They'll actually catch out Lashrak as well as Clockwork. So he gets the kill, and Arsart will be forced back. Okay, so obviously Lich was pretty low on life, and they expected him to actually fall back. With the headdress, though, he didn't really want to fall back. I think actually got given a salve out by the courier. But when you have a hero like that fall back, hello Arsart, he has no ultimate. He is forced to run back. Pachok! Try to actually pick up the Witch Doctor. Now Lich will just have fun with Dendi, or Dendi will have fun with Lich. It actually will probably go the second way I just said. Storm Spirit still hanging around the mid. Arsart will think about going this, especially now that Dendi's here. He's got his ultimate, and he will munch into that Ancient Apparition. They need to get that stun. They need to slow down Dendi. And they once you get it in the end, Witch Doctor with no mana. He has nothing left. So Dendi actually pops off the Urn Charge and will actually live through this. And they claim themselves up a couple of kills. That's the big, big play when you actually get in over your head. It's what's called overextending. And overextending is just basically when you, in fact, do exactly what it says. You overextend. You take a step a little bit too far, and you can't get your footing again. You can't get back, and you find yourself in the worst position possible. What I like to refer to as no man's land. And after that point, well, basically life is not good. All right, so, yeah. Lich, we've been through Ancient Apparition. We've seen him actually, well, he died recently. But we'll actually talk about him for a moment, too. It's a little bit of a slow. Oh, there goes the hook from Dendi. This is obviously a little bit more educational. So, yeah, if you're like, oh my god, talk about the game, man. Talk about the game. I currently am. Just not in all the ways. Just so people can actually understand what's going on. Storm Spirit actually running in, pulling the wrong creep. He pulled a melee creep. That ability you see there is Electric Vortex. You can actually cast and then walk yourself away. As you just saw him just then, he pulled himself a creep and was like, hey, that's not who I wanted. But it allows you, once you actually start the pull, well, nicely done. Wish Doctor picks up Clockwork Goblin on the top lane. Ancient Apparition's gonna be really careful right now. There's no warning around here, so they have no vision. But Dendi, he's always on the hunt. He's always throwing out predictive hooks. That's why a lot of Pudgers like to go with Arcane Boots. Yeah, it's gone a little bit differently, and now Dendi's actually caught out. So the time walk over the top, so there's that slow. Combined with the Cold Feed, he can't walk away fast enough. And Faceless Void gets the last hit. It was a bit of a combination to hold him in place there by the original time walk, which slowed him down, but also that level 4 on the time lock. So with every hit, he had that chance of a bash. He managed to pick it off too, and that held him in place just long enough for Ancient Apparition to do one of the first abilities we'll talk about him, which is the first one he always levels up, and that is Cold Feet. So you cast it, and basically, if the target doesn't walk away fast enough, you see that circle around it right now, that's the range of what he can actually cast. And the range is basically pretty much similar for how far you actually have to walk away from the Cold Feet. So you cast that off. If you can't walk away, though, if you get time walked, if you get slowed down, then you get frostbitten. You do take a little bit of damage over time as well. As you can see, 75 at level 4 and the 3.5 second stun duration time. So it does hurt off a little bit. And then you stack the ability of it too. So the damage resistance, 25%. So you want to try and pop that Ice Vortex below it as well. Also cast off that slow, so you can combine the two abilities together. So you don't have to rely on like the frost slow, the time walk, or things like that. The next item, next ability we see popping out, is actually the Ancient Apparition ultimate. So he was actually checking out the Roshan there. It does give vision for wherever it actually hits. Storm Spirit now wants to jump in towards the mid lane, going on the Wish Doctor, and he dies before he even has a chance to blink or cast anything. It's that big, big pull time. So there's that duration, 2.5 seconds of time to do damage, and Lashrak with that good split earth damage. So it's an AoE stun. Very, very circular effect. The casting duration time on that is actually pretty long, so it's not an easy stun to actually hit. Generally, it actually needs a setup stun like that Storm Spirit stun to actually get it to work. Once again, predictive hooks out there from Dendi, searching out for the Ancient Apparition behind the tower. Decides to rot the creep wave down. There's that Cold Feet, and there's that slow too, so that's that coupling of the two abilities together. So Dendi just walks himself out of range. And then pops off the urn charge with the amount of damage he's already taken. Needs to regenerate his life. And you can do that pretty easily through the urn charge. Urn charge, you get an urn charge with every kill that actually happens around you. TS missing the stun there. Pudge, long range hook. Of course, at level 4, that hook is very, very long in range. Throwing down the AA ulti, just in case anybody wants to come in. But yeah, let's actually finally talk about Ancient Apparition. So Ancient Apparition with that ultimate. Whatever it hits, it actually stops regeneration, both mana as well as health, for the duration of the effect, which is obviously very, very essential as well, because you want to actually try and shatter. So you need to actually drop below what I believe is actually 10%. So hit points for kill. So there you go. 10%, 11%, 12% with the three levels. You need to drop below your hit points of that. So for Pudge to drop below 10%, you would need to be below 200 to actually die. So if the ulti's on top of him, he's below 200, he will actually shatter, is what we call it. Denny's also just going to die naturally here. Well, not naturally. Five heroes killing you is obviously not that natural. But he will die from just standard attacks from the Radiant side. So yeah, great ultimate, especially during team fights. Whenever you actually, I'm talking about the Ancient Apparition ultimate. When you actually have a big, big team fight, and it's just those heroes that are a pain in the ass. They just sit there on low life, and then they fall back. The AA ulti hits. And all of a sudden, it's a completely different ball game. You can't drop below 12% HP, or else you're going to die. Storm pulling again. Juggernaut wants to jump it. Spins as she gets the last hit there on Lich before he has time to pull off his ultimate. There's that AA ultimate going to go and combine it with the Ravage. A lot of these heroes are already taking a lot of damage right now. Clockwork is guaranteed to die right now, but they won't get the Storm Spirit. In fact, he was actually, I think, moving around. And, whoop, Allo Faces Void drops down the ultimate. And that will be able to kill off Lashrak as well. So Ancient Apparition, she gets herself a double kill with that one. And Lashrak buys himself back into the game. Storm Spirit will have to walk himself away. His ultimate allows him to actually jump over time, but jump over spaces, but it forces him to actually use up his mana. Cold Feet now goes. They need a bounce stun. They're going to get it too, so I'm good. It's not that good. Gets brought down, and Vorse wants to jump in right now. He's thinking about getting Witch Doctor, who starts off his own restoration to keep himself alive. And Faces Void, a good couple of lucky backtracks just then, as Ancient Apparition gets hooked in there by Dendi. He can't actually get close enough to actually deal off the damage. So instead, he actually throws an urn charge. Seta can actually, whoop, nice stun there by Lashrak. Able to actually latch that hard stun, as I said, to actually land without a setup stun, but he managed to get it in the end. Ancient Aberration really caught on the wrong side of the river right now. He needs to get himself out of here. Problem is, though, he's going to walk straight into the retreating Lashrak, who will easily claim his life and does it with a lightning storm. Triple kill for the Lashrak, in fact. Yeah, Ancient Apparition, such an amazing ultimate. And we should also talk about Witch Doctor. He's the only hero from the Radiant who I've not described in any form of detail. So has himself a bouncing stun. Great for controlling our first team fights. Lich ultimate! Worth it to get the kill, man. Worth it to get the kill. Went over the big team fights. Now Dendi will take his life. So ultimate from Dendi will hold Lich in place while he's running. So the extra damage, the extra slow, and then his ultimate with the dismember, which deals off the damage, of course, with every single hit. Adds 75% strength-based damage. So for a big strength-based hero, it does a crap load of damage. And it's a very, very low cooldown too, only 30 seconds on that. That's why Pudge is such a great initiator. Gets teams really caught out of position. Well, let's have a look at Witch Doctor again. So bouncing cask, so stun duration, pretty constant. In fact, it's actually completely constant. So 1 second stun duration. Creep stun duration is actually a lot longer. The main reason for that is because Witch Doctor also doubles himself. So if you actually want to get a support hero who's good for pushing, he's a good one to actually go. Dendi, good hook! Picks up the Witch Doctor. And now Juggernaut actually ulting straight onto that Witch Doctor. Got a couple of lucky hits there because the creep wave hadn't spawned up just then. So we got all these hits on top of that Witch Doctor, then jumped in on the back of the Tide as well. Storm Spirit wants to jump in. Gotta make a little bit of a buff right now. Either that or try and kill off the Tide Under, who pops off his Ravage in the end. And Ancient Apparition kills off the Juggernaut. It was his ultimate that was actually on top of that Juggernaut, which got him, of course, as I said, below that 12%, 11% right now. And Dendi pulling Ancient Apparition into the Void ultimate. Void managed to actually pick off one of our heroes, it's our Lashrak. Or, not before he's actually brought down. Dendi's still trying to rot. Gotta be careful, he's setting up that tower too much, but he'll just rot himself to death if the tower doesn't deal enough damage. He popped off an urn charge to actually help himself out just then. Storm Spirit, very, very low on life. Lich with just a normal attack gets that kill. As Tidehunter's gonna look for another kill right now. Dendi! Hawks! It will be the cost of a Vorst. Maledict on top of him will ensure his death. And even dropping down the ultimate there from Witch Doctor, massive overkill. Did not need to do that, but did it in the end. Just wanted to ensure that Havorst died. Havorst, one of those, well, let's just say he's a pain in the ass player to actually go up against. Almost impossible to kill all the time. So, yeah, let's actually have a talk about our last one. I talked about Maledict. I mentioned just then, so it was cast off. It's that third ability. So as you can see, bonus damage. So it takes damage three times over, 4 seconds adding bonus damage for every 100 HP lost. So the more damage you do, basically the more damage the Maledict will then do to the person that's cast on. Great when you actually get it cast off on a whole bunch of people. Then it's actually amazing, absolutely amazing. The downside, however, is the casting range is so minimal, it's not funny. Like, it's almost melee. The range is just so small. Very, very hard to actually do. A lot of times Witch Doctor does use as a walking ward is the best way of describing him. The Restoration, you see that area around him, that's that healing area around him. So he pops off Restoration, and anybody who's actually surrounding him will get healed, and the heal will come at the cost of his own mana. So as long as his mana's up high, then he's happy as Larry. But he's also known as the Walking Medic because he also provides with mana. So it's these things called Mana Boots. I don't think we've actually got a single one on the Radiant side, but we'll check out the Dire. Hello, TP Dwarves top. Denny's actually caught out here by... Oh, that's a bit of a mistake there by Storm Spirit. He TP'd into the Chronosphere. So Storm Spirit is actually killed off by the rest of it, but it's a good actually attack here by Lashrak before he actually died. Overcommitment here by Na'Vi, but Clockwork Goblin jumps in behind as well. Ravage pops up just to hold him as well as Dendi in place. Havor still wants to try and retreat back out again. Dendi really getting frosted up. There's that Cold Feet, slow him down, and they will actually not get the last hit. There's that Denier I was telling you about, rot yourself to death. You need to ensure you get that last hit all the time on Pudge. Havor will actually die. So Faceless Void picks up his life. And Juggernaut is the only one to actually live. And Arsar actually going through that bottom lane to bring down that tier 3 tower, which they don't want to lose. And that's where we see the double TP coming down with that support. And if they get a couple of good lucky bashes off right now, they can actually bring Juggernaut down. Juggernaut, actually, with no life, with not enough mana for his ultimate right now. He'd love it because he just ripped this Faceless Void out. But he is forced back. Probably want to save it too in case he does actually have to spit himself out. Magic Immunity. Diffusal Blade, if he needs to pop it, he can do. Faces Void, there's that walk, and AA ulti will actually not trigger when he's actually in that spin. He does actually have that magic immunity, and Arsart will be saved off by the Storm Spirit. They're fighting right on top. There was mere distraction right then. He had to jump a long, long way in, so he has very, very little mana to actually do this. He has enough mana for one more jump, but it won't be enough. There's that bash, the time lock that comes out from Void. So powerful. And guess the damage. And there's that Mask of Madness I was telling you about. He had that popped off during that fight. So pop off the Mask of Madness, and there's your attack speed. So you can bring down your opponent a lot faster. Looks like Latrak is not just finished just yet. He has Ghost Scepter up too. So might think about actually chaining it off here with the Ancient Apparition, who has an extra bit of movement speed, needs to land that stun, but it's a good Chronosphere. Dendi actually missing his hook because the Ancient Apparition stopped for a second to actually cast that, as Void is unable to get this last hit. Latrak actually too much damage. Popped off that ultimate, and we'll have a chat about Latrak in just a moment after Dendi as she attempts this one last hook. Tries to get in front, but you're looking for any random hero that's actually here. We start to see only one who actually moved up, and Dendi is walking right into the main base. Ancient Apparition ulti will chain as well. It's going to hit Havorce. Actually, no Havorce. May actually steer clear of it for the moment. But the Malady might be enough to actually kill off Dendi. Took a lot of damage during that. Hook will actually grab on the Witch Doctor. But there's that Witch Doctor's also grabbing his life with that Maledict damage. Able to pop off in the end. But Clockwork Goblin grabs his life. Arsart trying to spin around. Magic Immunity, of course, means he is actually blocking as well as dealing damage to everything while he's spinning. They just want to bring down this tower as well as Rax. Ravage goes off once again. Latrak held out. So a lot of casualties from both sides for this match. Let's just still got that ultimate up, which is a big draw card right now. And Clockwork gushed up. We'll get frosted. Lich won't want to pop the ulti on this, and he might do it right now. The Storm Spirit's come in, especially now that Lich will actually die. Yes, he will. Clockwork with the rocket is actually the one who gets the last hit for that. And Storm Spirit managed to kill off the Ancient Apparition. Not before he managed to pop off his ultimate, but basically the ultimate actually had no effect in the end. And at the end, she got the full cast off on that. Cold Feet needs that walk. They're looking for some revenge with the Ancient Apparition, who bought himself back into the game. Because there's an option for any player who currently plays, for anybody who plays Dota. Same option, Hon. There's actually a buyback cooldown you do have on it, so you don't want to use it all the time. And it does cost you gold, but if you are dead, you can spend your money and bring yourself back to life again. So that's why if we look at Ancient Apparition's gold right now, he should have very, very little. In fact, yeah, only 400 gold and pretty minimal on the items. But it's important for him to actually be alive right now. To lose this is the main thing. So you remove the melee barracks, and these creeps become Super Size Me, or what's known as Mega. I like to call them Super Size Me. So melee barracks will make the melee ones bigger, and obviously ranged barracks will make the range creeps bigger. Hawk! Such a great initiation. AALD is going to hit off pretty nicely right now. Good Chronosphere as well. It will hold him in place. It'll be enough damage to the entire of Na'Vi. And, jump himself back out. Storm Spirit. Ancient Apparition got himself a double kill with that big, big ultimate in the middle. The damage was done. The shatter actually ended up happening. So Juggernaut and Pudge being brought down. Great combination to actually have that. Chrono to hold him in place, because the Chronosphere was enough to actually save off Tidehunter. He did actually die in the middle of that. And now coming back in again, it's because of this guy, Latrak. He can bring down these barracks so damn fast. And with the tower gone, the barracks are actually open to actually attack. But there's that backdoor protection. The barracks actually slowly regens, but it's all about how much damage you can do. Bounce done, and there's that regeneration I'm telling you about. It's the backdoor stopper, and Ancient Apparition Dolly will fly in. Havorce will get hit by this on the way back out, but he has not. He's not low enough on life, and this will actually make him low enough on life! Yes, it is. Faceless Boy brings down the Clockwork Goblin. Lich is on the run. He wants to try and catch up, and I think his phase boots have actually got him extra movement speed. He wants to go for the Storm Spirit. Pops off the mech. There's that walk over the top by Faceless Void. He tried to get close enough to actually get the kill there on the Storm Spirit, but it's unable to actually do so. And the Shrek eyes down in the trees. And stuns himself back out again. That's done. Goes demolished off the creep way at the tree line. Then he will go down as well. Tidehunter finishes off with that anchor smash. It's a good change that she did to the Tidehunter. There's a couple of patches to go in Dota 1. Anchor smash used to be a percentage trigger off, and now it's actually a castable spell. And there's those arcane boots I was telling you about. So generally you see those on Witch Doctor. Witch Doctor in the end actually went with strength dreads, realizing he's dying too much. Most of the time, you only need one. Lich is actually currently getting called out too. He does have that four star to get himself away, and there you go. Just pushing himself forward. Double click it, it'll push you whatever direction you're facing. Be it uphill, downhill, any way you want to go. You can also click it on any other unit as well, and it will force them as well. It's like Void might think about jumping up here in a moment. Juggernaut, I think, wants to jump down. He has that ultimate. If Storm holds him in place, Arsar can kill him off. So there goes that ultimate. Jump, jump, jump. You can't see anything because of the red balls, but he got his ultimate up! Great AA ulti! And then the lifesteal. They needed to finish him with that hit. Now the leap will come up and they won't just lose two heroes, they're going to lose three. They land that stun, but it's not enough. That's why Faceless Boy is really actually loved as a big carry hero. We saw him a couple of times during the international, and it was just for those times where it's just like, you know what? I can't deal with the Juggernaut damage. I can't deal with the Storm damage. I need to shut down this fight and give myself time to actually deal the damage that I need to actually deal. And that's what the Chronosphere actually offers you. Dandy now going to look for a bit of an opening. This is the second tier 1 tower to actually die for them, which is massively surprising 35 minutes in when it's 48 to 34 on the kill count. Clockwork also getting called out by Lich. Yeah, Faceless Boy, such an amazing hero with that ultimate. Lock him in place, beat the living crap out of him. And you saw the life he got back then too, allowed him to actually continue that fight. Instead of just going, okay, I've only got like 100... And at the point when he managed to pop off his ultimate, I think I threw him at about 50 HP. Which is nothing. By the time inside the ultimate, the life still he got from the Mask of Madness, and it goes the attack speed he got, so the speed of that lifesteal, that's the impressive thing. Hook! Picks up Tidehunter. He's four-staffed in a little bit further. He still actually has that Ravage if he wants to pop it, but he wants to save it for right now. Probably now's going to be the best time. It just on the edge. Stains off Lashrak. Stuns off Lashrak. But Faceless Boy with the double kill. More farm for him. And I'll be able to bring down this tower. Lightning Storm just trying to slow down the creep wave, but there goes the ultimate again, so Storm Spirit as well as the track. There's that AA ulti chain off again, if you can do enough damage to Storm Spirit right now. In fact, he has done so. It's that time lock holding you in place. It's what people hatefully refer to as permabash. Basically means you are permanently bashed, and it's permabash. And the mid will go down. And with that Miller Barracks going down, it basically spells GG. Juggernaut will be brought down. Lich with the Frost gets the last hit from that, even though Faceless Boy is doing majority of the damage. He also has a crap load of gold, 6.7k. As Horvost is actually hanging on the edge. Tries to hold Ancient Apparition in place next to the tower, but Ancient Apparition is currently four levels above him, and has a lot more tankability than Clockwork at this point. And the pull from Dendi, actually pretty nicely there on the Tidehunter. And Ty will actually go down. It's like Faceless Void, soloing. Now he actually brought up the Divine Rapier. Not an item a lot of people actually go, unless you actually get the security of an Aegis Immortal. So it's basically known as the Divine Aegis Strat. So the Divine Rapier will drop if you die. It's the reason why you generally want to be walking around with an Aegis Immortal when you do what you do, because it deals a crap load extra damage. You see, extra 250 damage with every single hit, which allows him just then to finish off Dendi. Then he wants to go one-on-one with Faceless Void. This should be interesting. 1v1 versus Suicide's a pet. Yeah, nice. And Lich actually getting called out there by Storm Spirit, but Maledict as well as great Witch Doctor ultimate until he gets himself caught in. At least Lich got himself a nice ultimate in too, and Ancient Apparition will chain it off. So Lashrak is basically already dead at this point. He won't live. That's why he's actually being left alone. He'll actually shatter himself to death. Below that 13% of his life. So Ancient Apparition gets the kill for him. Or kill on him. Juggernaut has that ultimate up, so he's trying to actually lure the Faceless Void away from the creep wave. Of course, if he gets a hit, a single hit on him right now, then he's basically dead. But Arsart needs to deal with this creep wave before he can actually do what he wants to do. The Force pops off the cogs in defense. And now Void jumps up. A quick blink away. But they still can't initiate on him. Ancient Apparition, so easy to kill off that Juggernaut. Two hits. This game should be ended right now before Na'Vi actually just leave. Na'Vi don't like it when you actually drag out their games. Which is completely fair enough. Look at the Void's farm. 227 last hits. 30 denies. Next 130 creep stats. Higher than anybody else on the Dire. And then of course the 15 for 4 is the big critical thing as well. Good Lich ultimate will basically destroy off everybody in the Dire. And with the AAL chained onto, it's complete genocide. So this will be GG. What we always love to do at the end of every single game is just wait for the stat screen to actually come up. And then we can actually have a look at the back there. So yeah, we might actually be going another one, which could be good. It's always good practice. Now vehicles training up for the ESWC, which is happening next weekend. That will be covered live here at joindota.com. And we hope to actually have you here for us. We'll actually be remotely accessing into the LAN servers for ESWC. That is going to be the cool thing about that. So, yeah, we'll actually be controlling our own camera. We won't be restreaming anything. And we'll actually be the official broadcasters coming out. So hopefully you'll join us for that one. We streamed out, as I said, from joindota.com. The quality will be a crap load higher than what it is right now. To God. Because also there'll be people restreaming off us, as we know, for that. As long as you are an own 3D TV person, you'll be allowed to actually do that, and we'll set you up with the ability to actually do so. All right, so thank you very much for actually tuning in. This is myself, Toby One. We'll be back here with more Dota 2 action in just a moment.